My name is Matthijs Lof. I'm an associate professor of finance here at Aalto University School of Business. My research is concerned with the empirical analysis of financial markets. I analyze prices, volatility, but also specifically trading volume, which is what this talk today will be about. So I'll start with a tweet by Elon Musk. So Elon Musk is the CEO and main shareholder of Tesla. He's currently very much in the news because he's trying to acquire Twitter. But he was also last year a bit in the news because he posted a poll on his Twitter asking whether he should sell 10% of his Tesla shares. So his followers said in quite big numbers, yes, please do. And so proceeded. Now, shortly after this, the SEC, one of the financial regulators in the US, launched an investigation into this because it turns out he already started to execute this trade beforehand. And this is what we call an inside trade. It's an insider in the company, in this case, the CEO, who's trading potentially on information that is not available to other market participants. So there's strong regulation involved in insider trade, and the SEC is currently investigating whether all rules were followed. The verdict is still out. Not out. So this led to a bit of a bump in trading volume in Tesla, which is already quite high. So over last year, 2021, over $5 trillion of Tesla shares were being traded. So there's an enormous amount. To put that in perspective, this is 700% of the market capitalization of Tesla, which means that on average, each share in Tesla gets traded, changes ownership 7 times during a year. Also, there are other firms like Twitter or GameStop, which experienced some turmoil last year. This turnover, share turnover, is extremely high. But even in more traditional companies like Coca-Cola, Apple, we see the turnover in a year easily reaches 100%, which again means that each share on average changes owners, gets traded once a year. So this is a much higher turnover than we see, for example, in other asset classes like houses or cars or pieces of art. From an economics point of view, this is a bit of a puzzle. Why do we see so much trade? So in economics, we have the no trade theorem, which says that there should hardly be any trade. In an informationally efficient market, all investors have access to the same information. And as a result, the price should reflect all this information. So for an individual investor, there should never be a reason to expect that the price will go up or down, and there will never be a reason to buy or sell based on public information. So this theory, on the one hand, is very much at odds with the empirical observation that we see very high trading volumes, lots of trading activity. So why do people trade? Well, I'm going to talk about 3 reasons to trade. One of them is liquidity, disagreement, and then the third one, insider trade. So let's start with liquidity. So liquidity here refers to the amount of money that is flowing into markets. At some point, lots of money is flowing into markets, people are buying stocks, but sometimes, like a river, this liquidity dries up. And sometimes there's even an outflow, that money is flowing out of the markets. From an investor's point of view, you can think of liquidity changing over a lifetime. During our professional life, we are working, earning salary, we're saving money, maybe investing some of that in the stock market. And after retirement, we are consuming and extracting money from the stock market. So that leads to buying over a lifetime and selling afterwards. Also, at shorter horizons, people can get a bonus or an inheritance and bring that money to the stock market. And someone wants to buy a house and needs to extract money from the stock market. Also, institutional investors like investment funds, mutual funds, they face inflows and outflows from their clients, and they will need to trade in order to handle these inflows and outflows, to handle these cash positions. So we have an ongoing paper with Alauddin Hammed from the National University of Singapore and my colleague Matthijs Lof, where we look at the inflows and outflows into mutual funds and see that the mutual funds trade in a predictable manner in order to balance these inflows and outflows. And that then leads to price pressures that turn out to be predictable. So that's liquidity-based trading. Then another reason for trade is disagreement. So this refers to two individuals, despite having the exact same information, building different beliefs. So this could be because of limited cognitive skills. People are not necessarily processing the information in the same way. This could be because of limited attention. This could also be because of behavioral biases. Some people are just generally more optimistic than others. So some people are buying, some people are selling, despite having the same information. So there's a large field of behavioral finance, that's what it's called, that's precisely concerned with this area of finance. How do people process information? How do people form beliefs and expectations? And how do people ultimately make financial decisions? So I have some contributions in this area as well. During my PhD, I worked on asset pricing models in which investors make heterogeneous expectations despite having exact the same information sets. And we looked at the price dynamics that result from these models. In a very recent project, together with Alexander Wiertz and Elias Rantapuska, we're taking another approach. We're surveying investors and we're asking them explicitly, why is it that you invest? So we're asking Finnish household investors, why do you invest? And it turns out that most Finnish households are investing precisely because they expect to make high returns, or they're not investing because they would expect to make low returns. In other words, this implies that they're disagreeing with the consensus opinion of the market at that point. So that's disagreement-based trading. We compare these survey results to a similar study that's conducted in the US. And there it turns out that people are more trading for liquidity reasons. They want to save money for retirement, or they want to put money away in case to protect against income loss stemming, for example, from job loss or health risks. So this means that US investors compared to Finnish investors are more trading for liquidity rather than these behavioral disagreement-based reasons. This kind of makes sense because here in Finland, due to a welfare state, we're already protected against income loss from losing a job or health reasons. So that way we don't need to invest for that reason. And that allows people to be more in a gaming mode when it comes to the stock market. And then the third reason for trading is insider trading. So this refers to individuals trading on private information that is not yet disclosed by the company. So someone inside the company has access to information that is not yet released and making profitable trades based on this information. This is obviously undesirable. This leads to an information asymmetry between the insiders and the outsiders, and they have an unequal, unfair playing field. So this is why in most countries there's strong regulation involved in insider trading, and in generally it's considered illegal to trade on private information. However, we have ample evidence, including criminal convictions, showing that there is insider trading. So that's why it's important to try to come up with measures that identify insider trade. So this is another research project, together with Jos van Bommel from the University of Luxembourg, where we're precisely trying to do that. We're trying to identify privately informed trade from the order flow. So what we do, based on an economic model, we show that the statistical distribution of trading volume changes when there's more inside orders coming into the market. So when there's no inside orders at all, everybody's uninformed, trade follows somewhat of a normal distribution. But then when more inside orders come in, these are all on the same side because people tend to either buy based on this private information or sell based on this private information, depending on the nature of the information. And that then leads to an order imbalance, and that has impact on the distribution of trading volume. I will not go into the details. But then we have a measure that we call VCV, which is a volume coefficient of variation of trading volume. This is the standard deviation of volume divided by its mean, and this nicely summarizes this change in the statistical distribution when there are more inside orders coming in. So we take this measure to the data, and we look at earnings announcements in particular. So earnings announcements are scheduled quarterly disclosures of information by firms where they disclose to the general public their quarterly results. And we look at our measure of information asymmetry in the days around these announcements. Now, what we see is that in, say, the 10 days before this announcement, information asymmetry is quite high. This is when insiders would have an informational advantage over the outsider. They know the numbers that are going to come out, but the general public has not learned about it yet. So then at that point, we see that VCV is quite high. This would be a bad time for an outsider to trade, for an uninformed investor, because it's very likely that the counterparty will be better informed market participants. Then at the announcement date, so that's day zero, this information asymmetry is partly resolved. There's information shared with the public, and that means that the playing field is leveled. So we see that information asymmetry drops and there's less opportunities for privately informed trades at that point. Then in the days that come afterwards, we see again new information asymmetries building up in markets. So we see this S-shaped pattern around earnings announcements consistent with our measure indicating privately informed trade. So like I said, privately informed trade is a problem. It's an unfair feature of markets. And this is why it's important to measure this. There's a fairly large literature trying to identify privately informed trade. Our paper is trying to contribute to this literature. And it is important for regulators who want to really detect insider trades. It's also important for other market participants to check the quality of the market where they're planning to invest. And it also offers all kinds of research opportunities. So using measures to measure informed trade allows us to study, for example, the dynamics of informed trades, the behavior of inside traders, the price impact of inside trades, and for example, the market conditions and the regulatory frameworks under which we see inside trade prevails. So overall, there's still a large and exciting area to be discovered here. Thank you very much for your attention.